scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may learn and inwardly digest them, that we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Come in. I'm glad to see you, and I'm relying on your ability to stay awake at this late afternoon after a very full day. And I want to greet the folks online, and so y'all can drink coffee and stay awake in your own way. So I asked the powers that be to make some extra handouts, so I hope they'll be coming up. But if you don't have a handout, sit next to someone who does have a handout. And these aren't the mystery of life. So for those of you who are with us in cyber world, if you go to portertaylor.com and go to workshop topics, all the handouts are there. So let me tell you what we're going to do, how this is going to work. And so the good news is there's going to be some interaction, and the sort of good news or bad news is that part of that you're going to tell your stories to one another, depending on how you see that. The bad news is that you have to listen to me for about 25 minutes. So gear up for that. I'll give you a little, this is the way this is going to work. I'm going to give you an introduction. This is my shameless advertisement. So my son and I workshops, and so I'm going to sort of talk about story and sort of briefly talk about the method, and then we're going to try it. And so I have a particular theme that I will explain to y'all. We'll look at a theological theme. I'll give you a little bit of time to think of a story in your life that fits that theme. So think of this as an AA meeting, and what happens here stays here, right? And then we'll get in pairs, and you'll talk to someone you don't know, and you're going to tell your story. And then we'll have, in our plenary, we'll talk about how did that work, and then we'll talk about what are other ways that we can use storytelling as a means of going deeper in our faith and a means of evangelism. So we're going to try to do all that and get out promptly at 4:30. I've just retired from being the Bishop of West North Carolina, and for 12 years as the bishop, I started every meeting with a poem. And I did that because I think we'd rather have Benjamin Franklin than Jesus. We'd rather have a logical, rational, linear sense of the holy rather than the. So poetry is a way of getting us into our right brain. So that's why you have some of these poems in your handout. So the first poem is from Mark Strand, called Eating Poetry. And because I'm a lecturer, I get to read all the poems. Ink runs from the corners of my mouth. I have been eating poetry. The librarian does not believe what she sees. Her eyes are sad as she walks with her hands in her dress. The poems are gone. The light is dim. The dogs are on the basement stairs and coming up. Their eyeballs roll, their blonde legs foam like brush. The poor librarian begins. She does not understand. My knees and lick her hand, she screams. I am a new man. I snarl at her and bark. I romp with joy in the bookish dark. Come in.
Sorry.
Please, find a seat with someone who has a handout so you can look off. When the Word made flesh gets inside us, we get to the basement. We get to the ground floor. We get to the place where we come alive. Part of our evangelism is that we think we ought to have Jesus on a shelf, and he's trying to drag us out of that library into the basement so that we know that this is not about reading about someone's experience long ago. This is about letting that good news get in us and freeing us to play in the fields of the Lord. About a year ago, I was flying somewhere to do something. I always wear a coat and tie on the airplane. And people will sort of wheedle out what you do, you know. And I usually tell people I was into human improvement. But this young woman, she was in her late 20s, sort of wheedled out from me that I was a bishop in the church. And she reached over and grabbed my arm, sort of pulled me closer to her. And she said, "The Bible, is it true? Is it true?" She couldn't make any connection in the biblical story. She wanted it to be true for her life, but she had that gap. Those stories made to her. Error into truth, sin into righteousness, death into life. In this moment, I think as a country, we are searching for a cohesive narrative. And I think this is the time for the church. This is a time for us to say we have a story that's big enough for everyone. Big enough to bind us together. Gene Houston says, if you do not mythologize, you will pathologize. If you do not have a sacred story that informs your individual stories or your corporate stories, then you will end up having a nightmare. As Michael Curry says, which I think is what we're going through as a country. How do we find a story that binds us together? We live as Christians in a mythic story that is true. And because it's true, it makes our lives, whatever we're going through, it makes them true as well. So news of the story of death and resurrection to a country and also a world that is desperately in need of a context, of a text to be with them so that they can make meaning. Because if we don't, then we'll just end up with this small little containers, this small little ways of identifying ourselves. I think of Paul after Paul's conversion, where Paul shows up and, you know, Paul's either a Republican coming to the Democratic Party or a Democrat coming to the Republican Party. And they're going like, dude, we know who you are. What are you doing here? You know? What are you doing here? And he's saying to them, something has happened to me that means I am changed and you are changed and the whole world is changed. If we don't have that vision of the New Jerusalem, I'm always astounded that so many Episcopalians, no one in this room, but so many Episcopalians are allergic to the book of Revelation. Because as a lover of mystery novels, the answers are always in the back of the book. So we know that in the Bible, the answers are the New Jerusalem. That's where we're headed. We're never going to get back to the garden where just people like us hang out. We're going to get to this wonderful city where all God's children are. Where all God's children are. And so we are called to give that vision to particularly this country at this time, but also to the world. So, I'm a huge fan of Richard Rohr. Like, everyone's a huge fan of Richard Rohr. How can you not be? So, just in case my little scribbles aren't very good, those of you at home will just have to live with the whole diagram. This is not rocket science, but it's on page 3 of your little handout. And those of you that don't have them, find me tomorrow and I'll make sure you get them. As I said, I thought they were going to bring some more over here. This has been the most helpful thing that happened to me. I went to see Richard Rohr in 1993 at a men's retreat. And I said, there's no way I'd be able to fire and help me over it. So it was extremely helpful. But this one diagram, literally was a conversion experience for me. Because what he says is that to have a coherent universe, you have to have three levels of meaning that cohere. And so the first level is we always start with my story. Who am I? This is your resume. This is what happens when you go to cocktail parties. You always start with, let me tell you, mystery novels, I have two kids, blah, blah, blah. So we're just running through our resume. That's my story. But this dome of meaning, finally, is so small. And if you want to read a frightening book about Episcopalian, read the book called The Big Sort by Bill Bishop, who is not a bishop, but is an Episcopalian. And he is a statistician, The Big Sort, S-O-R-T. He documents that we in America are clustering around people who act, think, shop, live just like we do. So we're sorting ourselves out into these little pockets. So eventually, this small dome gets so that it's just an isolated bubble. And we have to find other people. So we get to a larger dome where we have a tribe. So we find folks that agree with us. So I was a priest in Athens, Georgia for 9 years. And one of the religions in Athens was Georgia football. And so for six Saturdays a year, people would go to church at the Georgia football field and wear their sacred vestments and sing their hymns. Herschel Walker would be on the screen as their saint, and it was a religious experience. And I mean that seriously and most of
you. You did say Herschel.
We had that experience in Texas.
It's everywhere. The downside of it is that one of the bars in Athens was called Gator Haters. So it wasn't enough to like Georgia football, you had to hate the Florida Gators. So the problem with this dome of meaning, I'm a Republican, I'm a Democrat. The problem with this dome of meaning is that we define ourselves more about who we're not than who we are. And so at some point, this is insufficient as well. This is where we are in this country. Little circles that define themselves by who they're not as much as who they are. So we have to have a mythic story. Now you know from Deuteronomy, well, I need to speed up. You know from Deuteronomy that for Jews, Moses goes for 39 chapters telling people how to deal with crossing the river. And when he finally gets to the Jordan, someone tugs on his sleeve and says, so I don't know what you've been talking about. when we get to the promised land, what do we tell the kids? And he says, tell them once we were slaves in Egypt and God brought us out into freedom in the promised land. That's their mythic story. Ours is best said in Eucharistic prayer B, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Come on.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
That is our mythic story. And we have a coherent universe. My story is connected to the story of the body of faith, is connected with all the saints, both living and yet to come. So what we are aiming for is to connect ourselves, to a coherent universe by connecting my story to the story, which will connect us to our story. So I remember this. Now, my brother and sister actually are watching this in ether world. They're going to correct me because I don't know if it's actually true. It's true, but I don't know if it actually happened. So what I remember is that when I was 4 years old, my great-grandmother was dying. We were in Asheville, and my grandmother and her mother was in Asheville. And my mother took me over to see the matriarch, my great-grandmother, and with my brother and sister. Now, my brother's a trial lawyer, so you'll understand that in a minute, why that's important. So we're all standing there. I'm four, my twin sister's four, my brother's six. And I didn't know what to say. I didn't even know what it meant to have someone die. And my brother, being the future trial lawyer, says, "Are you scared?" The matriarch, my great-grandmother, says, "I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth, and though this body be destroyed, yet I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and not as a stranger." That's a coherent universe. That's where she knew that her death was connected to the death of all the saints, was connected to the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So what we are trying to do in storytelling is not entertainment, although it's always fun, because it's real. What we're trying to do in storytelling is to tell the truth and tell it to others so that we all can be connected. What a convoluted series of lines. So we can connect ourselves to the never-ending story of Christ's death and resurrection. So that, and I'll tell you the way I got into this, and this is something the church I've been a recovering alcoholic in the program for 25 years. And the only way that AA or any of the A's works is because you come, you sit down, you tell your story. And other people tell their story. And it's redemptive. Because it comes from here, and it's not about. It's whether you believe that telling your story has a power, not just for yourself, but the storytelling I'm interested in. How do we get to a deep enough place to tell stories about our own lives that connect with our brothers and sisters and connect us to the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ? And I believe that those who have given up on the church, and I live in woo-woo land in Asheville, North Carolina, those of us that have given up on the church have done so because they don't understand what this is and why it should make any difference to them. They don't understand that. When I talk to them, they say, "I think it's sweet, I just don't think it makes any difference." And so I think it's a fool's errand to keep trying to say, let me tell you this story because you don't understand how important it is. I think what we have to do is to start here. Let me tell you my story. And then let me hear your story so that we can find a common denominator and see. It's by flipping it upside down. We need to tell the story of our joys and our passions. Because I want to tell you this. Every book of Joan Chittister. And I begged her for 12 years to come to North Carolina, and I have yet to get her to come. But she writes this story. She says, I was an only child, and my parents and I had an early evening routine in our house. I'd get home from school around the same time that my father arrived from home from work. The minute I got in, I'd tell my parents what I'd learned in classes that day. I especially reveled in the opportunity to explain my religion to my Irish Catholic mother, who was proud of my explanations. My Presbyterian father was more than a little leery of things Roman Catholic. One afternoon, I did not stay to clean the chalkboards for sister. I knew it was absolutely imperative that I got home before my father did. I had to get things straight, check things out with my mother, just the two of us, Catholics, alone. My mother stood at the kitchen sink. Well, she said, you're certainly excited, aren't you? What did you learn in school today that's got you so wound up? Sister said that only Catholics go to heaven. Oh, really? My mother said. And what do you think about that, Joan? I took a deep breath. I think sister's wrong. And why do you think sister would say anything that's wrong, my mother pressed? Because, I whispered, sister doesn't know daddy. Her hands, pulled me up close, and said, that's right. That's right. We need to start where we are and tell the truth about where we are. So, this is my method. I have been working with my son, who's a therapist in Atlanta, and what I've done is to take different themes. So I've listed these possibilities. Those of you at home, they're somewhere on the website. They're on page 4. So these are just Porter's possibilities. You think of your own possibilities. But what I've done is I've come up with different themes about that surround our journey of faith. And what I do is I gather folks together and I do a teaching on one of the themes. I usually give them poems about it. I give them scriptures about it. I tell a story of my own about it. And then people think of, what's a piece of my life that goes around one of these things? And then we gather back. We first begin with our stories. What do our individual stories tell us about the never-ending story? I tend to do these. The best way I've done these is over weekends, so that you can do 4 or 5 of them. But I've also done them, as we'll do today, in sort of a one-shot deal. I do this because I think it's important for us to recognize sort of the movement of the Spirit, but I also think that it's important for us to hear one another and to work out what the journey of our Christian life means from the bottom up instead of the top down. Because of the election. But I'd rather, instead of us just spending 40 minutes doing a theological reflection on surrender and quoting C.S. Lewis and feeling sort of smug, is for us to get in here and to talk about, when did I have to surrender? When did I have to surrender? So this is not rocket science. I didn't read any book about this. It just came to me one day, and I've been doing it, and it's been helpful. It's been helpful. So let me stop for a minute and just see if there are any questions, and we're going to talk about surrender. Go back so you know where you are. We're going to talk about surrender. I'm going to tell you a very brief story of surrender in my life. I'm going to give you some time for you to think. So I know you'll start thinking while I'm talking, so you won't listen anymore. But I'm going to give you some time to think about a moment of surrender in your life, and you're going to write down a few notes. You're going to find someone you don't know. It's a little hard to move with all these stairs, but you can find someone you don't know, and you're going to tell your stories to each other. And then we're going to regather and see what happened. Okay? So I'll close my eyes if you want to run out of the room right now. All right. Any questions, though, about anything I've said so far? It's like Friday afternoon, right? Okay. If we have time, remind me, I want to tell you something about Martin Buber, but we'll have to see later time. All right, so let's start with surrender. If you'll stay on page 4, and those of you in virtual land, this is Awake at Night by Wendell Berry, which I... And if you don't like Wendell Berry, you and I are not going to be friends. It's kind of a deal breaker. Awake at night. Late in the night, I pay the unrest I owe to the life that has never lived and cannot live now. What the world could be is my good dream, and my agony when dreaming it, I lie awake and turn and look into the dark. I think of a luxury in the sturdiness and grace of necessary things, not in frivolity, that would heal the earth and heal men and women. But the end, too, is part of the pattern, the last labor of the heart. To learn to lie still, one with the earth again, and let the world go. Late in the night, I pay the unrest I owe to the life that has never lived and cannot live now. Last night, I woke up at 3 o'clock wondering, is this workshop going to work? Surrender is coming to the end of what you can do and taking a step into the emptiness. And I always think of that scene in Harrison Ford, later Raiders of the, oh, that's not it, the one about the Holy Grail.
Yeah.
And he can't see the step yet. That's what surrender is. Surrender is where we fall into the hands of the living God. The best book, I think, that Joan Chittister ever wrote is Scarred by Struggle, Transformed by Hope. Just a magnificent book. I've given tons of those books away. So on page 6, I stole some of her stuff. I'm not going to read the whole thing. You're all literate. But I'm going to read just a little bit of it. So, third paragraph down. Surrender is the crossover point of life. It distinguishes who I was from who I've become. Life as I had fantasized is ended. Think of Hillary Clinton on Monday before the election and on Wednesday after the election. What is left is a spiritual obligation to accept reality so that the spiritual life can really happen in me. Surrender is the moment in which we realize it is time to become someone new. Surrender is not about giving up, it is about moving on. End of that, of the next passage. There is a time to let surrender take over so that the past does not consume the present, so that new life can come, so that joy has a chance to surprise us again. There's a wonderful book by Sam Keen called Learning to Fly. Any of y'all know that book? Sam Keen, when he turned 60, I'm 66, you can say, you don't look 66.
You don't look 66. You don't look
66. 65.
Sam Keen, when he turned 60, learned how to fly on the trapeze. And he wrote a book called Learning to Fly. And he has this wonderful chapter where he said, having one bar was pretty simple, just back and forth, back and forth. It's when you have the second bar and you let go of the first bar and turn, hoping the second one is there. Letting go of the first bar. So, let me just see if there's anything else I want to say about that. So here's my story, and we're on time. What a great thing! Here's my story. I was nice, and my brother and sisters. Well, my brother wasn't nice, but my sister was nice. And my parents were nice, and we were in a nice neighborhood, and we went to a nice school, and my father had a nice job, and we had a nice church. And I grew up thinking that if you played by the rules, your life would work. So I studied hard. I wasn't all that smart, but I studied hard. And I didn't make as good as grades as my twin sister, but I made good grades. And I worked hard in athletics. And played in all kinds of sports and got into University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill, and didn't know what to do with my life, so I got an MA in English and started teaching. Felt called to the ministry, but when I found out what the process was in Atlanta, I said, there's no way I'm doing that. So I went and got this weird degree from Emory, which was literature and theology, so that I could take all the Bible and courses. And my wife and I got married the day we graduated from college. She's a nurse and has always kept us solvent. So in 1982, we were 32 years old, and we discovered we couldn't have children. And I could not figure out how that made sense, because I believed in the mechanical universe, that if you did this, then this happened. And I thought, I had this deal with God that if I behaved, my life would work. That was the deal. And suddenly, that rule didn't apply. And I did not know what to do. I went into a huge, I don't know the word, devolvement. I began to sort of isolate for myself, for my friends. It was not something I could talk about. Christmas was a disaster for us. I have an older brother and a twin sister. They all had kids. So we... It got so that I didn't want to be around our friends who also had children. And I felt like Job. It's like, why have So we were living in Atlanta, and I saw this weird ad in the Atlanta Constitution, back when we used to read newspapers, that said that social services were accepting applications for potential children to be adopted. And you were to come to the social services office in downtown Atlanta. There was this couple across the street from us who were in more or less the same situation. They were both a little older, they were 35, hadn't had children, and was something that the woman's name was Melinda. Melinda really just didn't want to talk about it. So I got up at 6 o'clock and I figured this would be, but it was February. I got up at 6 o'clock. It was cold for Atlanta. So I drove through these dark streets of downtown Atlanta, parked my car, and there was already people in line. So I was standing there waiting for the sun to come up in February. And I looked around, and about four people back, there was Melinda from across the street. And I went over to talk to her, and we couldn't even talk. It was just, but we both wept. And something opened up in me. Something just happened in me. I was still on the edges of understanding anything theological. I'd started going back to church. But I just, what came to me was, you can't make this work. It's not about you. It's not about you. And I realized, I said to myself, you're going to live your life regretting what should have been instead of living the life that you're called to live. So I signed the forms, got in my car, and I just felt this sense of a letting go of a future that I thought ought to be. And I said to myself, together anymore. was that I felt for the first time in maybe a year, I was in the present moment. I had no idea about the future, but I felt like I'm here. I'm actually here. I'm actually here. That's surrender for me. Into the hands of the God who's alive. So, it feels like that's a little showstopper, so I should have told a few jokes before. What can I say? It's my story. So, what I want you to think about what's a moment, what's a turning point in your life? What's a turning point in your life? It can be as simple as thinking that Georgia was going to actually win. What's a turning point in your life where that you were in control to knowing you weren't in control? And I'm going to give you almost 10 minutes to think. You're welcome to walk around and to make some notes. And then I'm going to ring my little bell on my phone. And then you're going to find someone you don't know. And y'all can move chairs or do whatever you need to do. This is sort of an awkward room to move around in. But you'll have, tell stories to one another. Okay, does everyone understand what we're doing? And if you're an off-the-chart introvert that scares you to death, don't worry, because we all like each other. So let's maintain silence so that we can think. We'll give you 9 minutes. Those of you in the ether world, write your story in the comfort of your own home. So, I didn't tell you a couple of things. The main one thing I didn't tell you, just in case, because you could have been doing this, but I forgot. One of the things I want you to do is, we'll have a plenary after this, and we're going to talk about this experience, but we're also going to talk about other ways to do storytelling. So what I want you to do is, if you have an idea about that, write it on this and put it on this door. We'll have a little collage of ideas. So that way you're able to do that. All right, so all y'all stand up. Now the rules are, you're going to get 5 minutes apiece. You can see how crowded you are, so if you promise to come back, you can go other places as long as you don't disturb anyone else. It will work better, honestly, if you find someone you don't know, because then you'll just have your story in common. You won't have all that other stuff. So I have no idea how many evens and odds we have here. So,
a lot of odds.
Let's, first of all, everyone find someone to be a storyteller with, and if there's a person left out, I'll join them. So let's make sure everyone's got a person.
Thank you.
E.T., thank you for your story. He said, don't say E.T.
Carl,
as I think when you turn after him.
Storytelling that you can incorporate in your parishes. There are all kinds of ways of doing this. I'll give you a few that I know of. But what did you learn about surrender, and or what did you learn about telling and hearing stories? Yeah.
How much we had in common. And as we told the story, the connection became more obvious.
Yeah. The never-ending story.
Right.
Yes.
Right. Vulnerability, both in the storytelling and in surrender.
And do you think we're a very mixed group, or do you think that that would happen also in your congregation where everyone knows everyone?
Yeah.
What?
I think it might be harder to be vulnerable with people that I do. Well, I wouldn't be afraid of judgment, I think.
Okay. What else? Yes.
Respectfully, I disagree with that. I think when you strip yourself and figuratively stand naked in front of somebody, that it can be the most healing thing in the world.
Yes.
Absolutely.
I really do. And I mean that with total respect. I truly do. But it is hard to be vulnerable with people you know. But when you take that step and say, this is who I am, this is my hurt, this is my pain, it lessens it.
Well,
maybe I didn't complete my thought. I think that vulnerability is the key ingredient to surrender. And it was difficult in the storytelling example to be vulnerable with a stranger, and it's difficult in surrender to be that vulnerable. But I agree with you that that's when healing happens.
Mm-hmm. I do think, in my experience, it's imperative that you as the leader have to make this a safe space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
And have to clearly define the boundaries of it, both in terms of what happens afterwards, what are our expectations about confidence? Someone over here. Yeah.
I think that walking before you run helps. So in other words, a little bio before you get to the incident is a helper, certainly for the speaker, possibly for the perceiver.
Yeah. Yes.
The importance of practicing your ability to share the story and also the willingness to learn how to listen intently.
Yeah. That's right.
Actively listen.
And part of that listening, this is a whole other session which we're not going to have, but part of that listening is.
Right.
We're listening.
Listening.
Yes. This is your story. I can interpret my story, but this is your story.
Right.
What else? Yeah.
Porter, I think for me, there's an element of detaching from my story.
Yeah.
So that I can focus on and enter into the other person's story.
Exactly. that's part of that.
Really focus on
non-interpretation.
Exactly.
You know, it's like you remember Jumanji. You know, you open a book and you're in a different world.
Right.
Well, that's someone up here. Is a true story.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sometimes it makes us look this way, sometimes it's this way, but it's what matters is it's a true. You know? And we know that. You know? It's why you have in the most productive workshops that I do, we have a weekend and people have a big block of time, and sometimes they have overnight to think of what they're going to
write. I find when you start telling those true stories, you begin to see the Christ in the other.
Yes.
And I think it's only when you do that encourage the theology, I think it's important.
And it's the never-ending story. We're all going to the cross. We'll all experience betrayal. We'll all be Judas. I mean, we play all those parts. So having that common story among us enables us to be honest with each other, because we're all on this journey. We're in different places, but it's all the same journey.
So being a layperson, more sociologist than theologian, but I wonder about how hungry we are to do what we just did, that we have to hate it, come to a workshop to do it.
Or pay a therapist.
When we do workshops and, you know, experiences like this, we're always kind of setting up the rules about, you know, please listen, and then you gave us good guidance of please thank the other person. And we do all countercultural this is. And how you have framed it, because you've really fed my soul today. So,
thank you. I want to tell you, this is sacred work, and I backed into this because I've been writing this memoir about what an amazing experience that is. So let's talk about. I'll tell you how I've seen this happen. And then let's brainstorm, and if you, if you, helpful to sort of put them up, so if you want to do that, that's good. So I mentioned this in the group that met before. There's a Lutheran church in Minnesota. Is anyone here from Minneapolis? There's a Lutheran church in Minneapolis that has once a month has a story and they come and tell their story, and it's thematic. And I thought, what a wonderful thing is to bring people out of the congregation and to have them have a month to prepare and invite folks to come and listen to their story. So that's a model that I've seen. Right? Yeah, I think that's right. Remember that public narrative project? me, the story of us, the story of now. So that's there's a different version of storytelling. For those of you that are in Christian formation in one way or another, this would be a great thing to do seasonally. What's the story of Lent? What's the story of Advent? What's the story of Epiphany? And to how are those, I tried writing my memoir around the seasons of the church, and it didn't really work. It's a great idea. But I think that would be a fun idea to think about who is living Advent and to have them tell that story. Who is living Epiphany and have them tell that story? Those are possibilities. What are your possibilities that you think of how you might translate this to where you are?
We're doing quarterly, most of the time, issue of a ministry newsletter that I edit Steve John the Word, curate. And basically, I'm soliciting short, 150, 250 word stories from people in their own words.
Right.
And they don't have to be a writer. They should be on email, or I'm happy to talk them on the phone and just translate. But, how is this ministry? Give me a moment. A Polaroid snapshot. It can be a very small thing. An encounter you have.
I love all this stuff because it adds. We often use a timeline to get people started because
yes.
I think a lot of the people in this room are quite engaged.
Yes.
But when people aren't engaged, having a timeline of their life and simply asking them to write not the good things, but the times when they most encountered God gets people on that thought.
And if we had long enough on the back of your handout, I stole this from the guy in Minnesota, whose name I forgot. So on the back of the handout, there are these storytelling guidelines. So, because again, you want to just tell your story, you don't want to interpret it. So the more detail you can offer, how cold was it, who else was standing in line, what was the parking lot like, what car did Melinda drive when she drove up? Who greeted you at the desk when you went to talk to them about how to sign up? Just all those kinds of details are really what we need in order to be in that story with you.
Yeah.
What else?
Yes. I've used storytelling as a tool in conversations on racism, where I pair people and ask them to talk about their first awareness of racism. And the same thing with white people.
Absolutely. Yes.
I've used it in multicultural bridge building in a Latino congregation and an Anglo congregation. And read a book called Enrique's Journey, which was both in English and in Spanish. And we used the book as a point of departure for storytelling. And it was very profound. It had an effect on the congregation that bound them together, that as long as those same people are alive, they will never part. And in fact, our congregation has been invited to go to other congregations and share the same exercise over a period of
visions and the goals and get people to really understand those because we use stories, we use metaphors. And we went back about, oh yes, it was like this. What the future's going to be. So it applies across the board.
Thank you. Yes.
I was asked about 14 years ago to interview some people on a local TV station. And it was because our interim priest couldn't go. And so I thought, well, I'll go. I've never done anything like this. And as you know, it's still going strong. Every week I interview someone, and it's called to serve. I like to find out how they have responded to God's call on their life. And I believe and the presiding bishop and George Carey when he comes over here, and a lot of people, and people true meaning of where God is. And I keep saying, well, I'll stop the moment the stories dry out and they don't seem to
dry out. So in our community, we did a class in formation and storytelling for the purpose of being able to minister to a group that we bring food in, homeless people that come in for food. And those who did not go to the formation, those who had gone, and as we laid hands on the homeless and shared our stories with them and received theirs, the people who did not go to the formation experienced how to tell story and how to receive stories.
Nice. Thank you. So I have a favor to ask you. This is just for me, because as polite Episcopalians, we shake your hand and say nice sermon, whatever you think. You know, so, it would be helpful for me to get some feedback. So if you have time, if you fill these out and just leave them right up here, that would be helpful. And I have a story that we're going to close on. Luther tells that I think is redemptive. He says, a rabbi whose grandfather had been a pupil of a famous rabbi was once asked to tell a story. The story ought to be told, he said, so that it itself is a help. And he told his story. His story was, my grandfather was paralyzed. Once, my grandfather was asked to tell a story about his teacher and how his as my grandfather told much that he stood up to show the movements of his great teacher. And the more he told the story about his teacher and what a great dancer is, he began to move his legs until finally he was dancing around the room. We don't just tell a story or hear a story for information. It's about transformation. It's about how we go from being lame, as I said earlier, from error to truth, from sin to righteousness, from death to life. Thank you.
Thank you.